So yes, I'm Jamie Hancox. I'm the founder of Commerce Futures. This thing is my idea, so hopefully I can talk us through the theme and why we've decided to talk about community and the links between community commerce and content today. I'll introduce my panel quickly. Simon from Brown's Fashion, Troy, who's used to be from Secret Escapes, is now from Endorse, and Lee Williams from Haymarket Pistonheads. I'm going to ask them to introduce the businesses and talk about them in a minute, but we specifically wanted to now that we know that the world of commerce and content and community are converging, I specifically wanted to find some people to talk about their different perspectives, coming from a retail world, coming from a media world, coming from a community world, to talk about how everybody sees the blend of these three levers, if you like. So if I start there and ask you each in turn to introduce the business that you run and just give me an idea of the how you use those three levers in the business today, let's do that as a sort of scene setter. Rules of engagement are, if you want to ask a question, do it straight away. And don't hesitate, please, because we're a small group, so we can get very lonely.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. So Brown's was very recently, up to now, a family-run business. It's a luxury fashion retail and very much an omni-channel business today. It has been for the last few years. We're located in South Moulton Street. We have a satellite store in Sloane Street. And we're reputed for, and it's really credit to my mother, for discovering talent and designers. We've introduced probably some of the biggest designers in the world through our shops, and certainly today they're supported by online. We are currently about 100 people, and we have pretty much a robust in-house online team.
Thank you very much. Troy?
So I'm Troy, I'm one of the founders of Secret Escapes. Secret Escapes is a flash sale private members club for luxury travel. We've got the kind of Whispering Lady television commercial, which hopefully you've seen. I left Secret Escapes in about August of last year and started a fashion business called Endorse.com, which kind of does what it says on the tin. We source the products that have been editorially endorsed by the fashion media. So we are a shopping platform where every product featured has been hand-selected by the all fashion's most influential editors, stylists, and bloggers. And the reason why we think that's a good thing is because using that kind of knowledge base and leveraging the decisions of the subjective decisions of what you should and shouldn't buy from the people who pay the most in the world to make those decisions, we think is a good way to help curate great fashion and new designers and bloggers. So that's us.
Great side. So Lee Williams, I head up digital revenues at Haymarket. We're talking today about Pistonheads, which is a particularly exciting brand, to talk about how it's leveraged community to create a commercial business model. It's one of media's best kept secrets. It's the number two motoring site in the country. If you go to Hipwise and take out those little sites called Twitter, Facebook and YouTube, and you find that the two biggest social networks in the UK are actually Mumsnet and Pistonheads. We have over 39 million posts to date, 8,000 every day, predominantly blokes, talking about cars and things that they wouldn't talk about in front of women. So
cars,
what I hope to do...
Cars.
Cars and all kinds of things. So hopefully what we'll do today is give some insights on how we've nurtured that community and sort of leveraged that community to build a pretty exciting commercial model that takes on some of the biggest digital beasts in the UK, such as Auto Trader and eBay.
So let's start by talking about the community, this idea of community. So I want to ask you, when does a community become one? When is it just an audience or a bunch of engaged people who have paid to be a member of your travel business? What's the difference? When does a community start being one? And when does that start contributing financially to you? You know, if I think about Browse, for example, you're a store owner, but having read the press recently, you're described as being the most loved fashion business in the UK. So you have this persona as being very heavily loved. Is there a community of interest there, and when do they become one? And
well, I think you've got to come back to the core. You know, what's the core business? And clearly, if people come to Brown's and they continue to come, it's because after 45 years, we're still relevant. And I think that's one of the key advantages that we have on a lot of people. We've been consistent. And I'm going to just open it up to, I'm going to take this community thing from a different angle, because I was about a year ago, we were asking ourselves, well, what's really important in terms of addressing our customer? And it was clear to us that we had to have one message, online, offline, one message, because we want to be consistent. And I think having a very clear message about who you are and what you're doing, and of course it's got to be genuine, of course enthuses people and it builds loyalty. So from a community point of view, our customers come to us because they know they can find what we've been reputed to always doing, discovering talent. You'll come to Brown's because there'll be something new.
Is it really that idea that we know more than you do? We can help you. We can tell you what to wear. Is that what the community comes to Brown's for? Do you think that expert advice?
I think the consumer today, in any case, is very well informed. I mean, the information is out there, and it's true that our sales people are savvy, and they have to be. And the advice that we give our customers is very much on a one-to-one. And of course, there's a big, there's a trust element in it, but it's the knowledge of the product and what we're doing and the story behind the product that we unveil. The customer is very well informed, so it's pretty basic when it comes to to selling a product. You've got to make sure that it fits the customer. And one of the things that we don't do, I'm certainly adverse of doing, is trying to sell something that somebody doesn't want or doesn't look good on them. So I think the customer is very well informed, and there's this interaction between us and the customer, and making sure that product is what suits them.
And Troy, you've worked in, you've had members' businesses with huge numbers of members. Mm-hmm. What do you think about the idea of an audience versus a community, for example, and how that plays out commercially?
So I guess it depends on your definition of community. So with the new business
we forgot to define that at the beginning, because I'm a bad moderator. So let's assume I've done that.
It's open. So with my new business Indoors, we're actually leveraging one community in order to better inform another community, in a sense. So the whole concept of the site is to take the community of the professionals, the experts in the fashion industry, the editors, the stylists, the bloggers, etc., taking their opinions that are publicly available and forming that into a much more useful index, I guess, which better informs the community that we're growing, which are the audience. And so we're kind of trying to solve a similar problem to what Brown's is, I think, but using the knowledge base of one community in order to give the knowledge to the people who we're trying to sell the clothes to.
And is that, I suppose we were talking about the decline in Google searches recently, and I wonder whether or not Indoors is a business that benefits from the fact that we don't use the Google search tool as much as we did as consumers. We kind of know what we like a lot more nowadays. Google are seeing a decline in search volumes. And I know that you have a particular view on how your community plays into that that world.
Yeah, this is really exciting. So you can imagine you've got 4.5 million unique users. It's quite a big number. The reality is that in the community, there's probably about 40,000 individuals who regularly post in that community. So it's not such a daunting challenge as you may start the journey on. What you're trying to do is get the real passion experts and opinion makers into that community. The rest will then lurk and occasionally contribute. But what you get out of that is the most amazing depth. So you were fortunate enough in your time to own a TVR. Actually, you're at Bristol here as well. You go onto the TVR community inside Pistonheads, which is a church of many churches. It's intense. If you wanted to understand how to recondition the engine, where the best suppliers are, who designed this, what modified that. It's huge context that came from members of the public and all their handles, and people can see all that history. So they've become the true experts. And we, the content combination, we occasionally look at that and bring it to the fore. We edit, not curate, I hate that word, edit. It's a great word. And then bring it to the fore. We then also, due to that process, the manufacturers like TVR recognize that impact. And so they come to us and let us go first to release latest news, like they're coming back into the market, for example. So it becomes self-perpetuating in that location. What the exciting thing is, a bit tangential, is we launched a product last week called Ask Pistonheads, which is 39 million posts. And we've done tests after test, and we think that search engine's better than Google, because the content we have in there is not spam SEO pages, I'm sure you've all built in your time, I have. You know, it's proper true content and trustful content. And it's trustful because people have commented backwards and forwards and self-regulates itself. So it becomes a very exciting part of the mechanism. But you know, once you can get it fueled, that's the hard bit, the fueling of it, it starts going.
That's interesting, isn't it? So you were just mentioning Google spam pages. We'll talk about content in a little while, but what's the view of the audience today about that sort of content? I mean, obviously everybody's building it because I looked at the audience, everybody laughed. Who here is doing less kind of basic Google SEO type content now and spending more time producing other kinds of content? Quick show of hands, who's still doing SEO for SEO's sake? Nobody. Nobody. Everybody's changed. That's all right.
We do SEO.
So you think that this content can be another source of claiming members and by-stepping Google?
Well, I suppose my inkling is that an audience becomes a community when it starts talking to each other. Mm. That would be a sort of reasonable.
I think where you can, where Pistonheads can obviously beat Google is, and in other industries as well, is when you specialise very specifically on one. I mean, Google is everything, right? Yep. So they can't, and that's similar to, you know, if you look in fashion, Instagram is ultimately an awesome fashion search engine for fashion images. But the fact is that Instagram is it's a photo sharing site. It's not been built from the ground up as a fashion site, so it doesn't have things like taxonomy. It doesn't have understanding what, you know, how do you categorize clothes or whether or not what sex it is and these sorts of things. It's literally just photos. So you guys obviously can capitalize on the sort of, you know, deep, intense knowledge of the TVR community, because actually you don't have to worry about whether or not it fits into any other category. And that's where I think, you know, specialist sites that focus on a specific vertical can actually beat the big incumbents. And it's like having 90% of the small niche as opposed to 1% of the, you know, the larger bit.
And just quickly, before we sort of finish on that this community element, there's a blend, isn't there, of online and offline. Obviously, you're an omnichannel business. How does Pistonheads take its community and turn it from an online community only into something that's more?
There's two methods. First of all, the community highlight within that process. They make their own friends and promote and set up their own events. We've got a chap in Bristol who runs an amazing one every Tuesday. Every month at the docks, and 400 cars turn up to have a coffee and hang out, and we do that ourselves every Sunday.
Don't laugh at us. Every, just men being men.
Every 3 weeks.
Before
ourselves.
We talk about cycling, it could get a lot worse.
So free of charge, we run Sunday services, and so we will go to pretty one of my interesting examples. Aston Martin's a great one. We will go to Aston Martin, they open it all up for us, 400 people come in via invite, do the factory tour. Again, a lot of coffee drinking in our business. Mm-hmm. We must get a sponsor, actually, anyone here? and you know, that basically collates that process. They share that for us, and it becomes, you know, a kind of vibe that goes on. Interestingly, a number of manufacturers, also we send very, I've actually love your model, Secret Escapes. I've kind of cloned it a little bit. We for car manufacturers, we send people to very special secret events, and car manufacturers pay us good money for that. And as a member, you will get a special invite that we don't tell anybody about, just you. You might tell everybody else about it. And it's a very nice process of getting people to, and for any brand here, particularly fashion brands, you've got that access. Get your members very covertly there, let them do the talking. The reality is they convert. They convert to sales, and the experience they get is phenomenal. And particularly when you're talking at high-end levels, if I'm talking about supercar and prestige car manufacturers, for that customer to take half a day or a day out of their lives, their busy lives, running a business, if you can create that environment, it's pretty special. So there's a number of kind of ways to do that. And then probably the final one we do, which I'm still recovering from 3 weeks on, is Le Mans, where we take 400 customers, members, to a campsite, and that's one of the most amazing things ever. It's a secure campsite. You've got, I remember particularly, three city boys with their Ferraris and their champagne fridge. It's phenomenal. And next to it, two early 20 lads in their souped-up Honda Civics. And for 2 days or 3 days, they were all together, all as one. Probably wouldn't talk to each other passing the street. In fact, probably would shoulder bar at each other. But actually, for that moment in time, they were together on one common theme. And that's a really magic thing.
I just want to add something. I think this content for me is very much about retention, customer retention. I don't think you acquire customers through content. I think you attract them, but you in fact I think you retain them. And that content has to be it's got to be authentic, and it's got to be relevant.
Interesting, you've taken us on to the second point in the agenda I wrote, but now I can't remember.
I told you, Jamie, I'd be
there. You've been very useful so far. just before we do that, so there was one thought that struck me about content within the community. So Secret Escapes has is a member only site, and yeah. I've never, but I'm as a family guy. I'm not sure I'm right for Secret Escapes because it's a
family holidays.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay. But okay. So if I go to I'm going to Legoland with my kids on Monday, right? And yep. I'm looking for restaurants to go to on Monday night because I'm staying.
Yeah.
Bad idea.
Yeah.
I don't want to. I'm looking at TripAdvisor and I'm looking at people's reviews and I'm thinking I'm not like you. Mm. I don't accept your review because you're not like me. Mm-hmm. That's content, right? That's the most vital content. So the same thing you were just talking about. Yeah. You want content. You want to see content within a community from people who are like you, who you either trust or know more than you do.
Your peers.
From your peers. That's well, peers, but people you certainly whose opinion you respect.
Yeah.
How does that work at Secret Escapes in any way? Do those guys review for each other or with each other? Have you tried that?
It was a funny thing when we did do a bit of testing for reviews of hotels, but actually we realised that it was our voice that the customers listened to the most. So every single hotel that we feature on the site, we've got a very kind of strong editorial kind of policy about how we describe it, what's in it for our secret escapers, if you like. Yeah. And when we did do a few tests with introducing things from TripAdvisor or other reviews, we actually had a drop in conversion, believe it or not. And I think it was just a bit of a information overload. And so we do, I think I'll steal from the founder of Fab when they were in their heyday. He used to talk about how that Fab used to, Fab.com, I'm assuming Fab. They used to curate an audience with their products. So they used to curate their community by virtue of the types of products that they featured on the site. And in a lot of ways, I think that's what Secret Escapes does very well. By virtue of the quality of the products that we feature, we've got a very strong belief that the deals that you see on the site, if you wouldn't be prepared to pay full price and it's at a discount, then it doesn't pass our editorial policy. That's the kind of underlying concept. And so that certainly does engender a certain community, I guess. They don't necessarily talk to each other.
They probably do at the pool.
Yeah, well, exactly. I mean,
it's sort of. How much did you pay?
And that's, well, actually, our new advertising campaign is this sort of hashtag smug face. And so we're trying to capitalize on that sort of side of things where, it's quite a feeling of great pride when you get a really cheap holiday that you would have happily paid full price for,
yeah.
and the guy sitting opposite you has paid full price. You kind of feel a little bit smug about it, right? So, and that's kind of what we're doing. So yeah, there's I think it's more of a, it would be great, I think, if they had much more communication, but that's, you know, we're not a forum site, so we don't need to necessarily push that because it's a different type of business. But certainly the community itself, when I tell people that I was involved in Secret Escapes, you know, it's generally a unanimous, oh my God, I love that. I've been on 3 or 4 of them. And it's like, yeah, and they all say the same thing. So
to come back to your point, Simon, when you talk about content needing to be authentic, but it's possibly the fact that in your position as Browns, having established that you're the opinion leader, that's what one of your roles to play in the retail market. You're advising people. Your value, your opinion is of great value. I wonder what the relationship is between user-generated content on the one hand and expert content from Browns, for example, on the other hand, as being able to improve the participation from the community in the first place, but also to drive revenue, because in the end, that's what we're all trying to do, right? We're all trying to create a level of engagement which sells product, sells music through the NME website or whatever else. Mm-hmm. Lee, if I start with you.
I think it's a pretty critical one. So, you know, you look at so many sites are now trying to incorporate user reviews. They said buying in from a range of brand names, and most of them are frankly vanilla. And to the point, they're not necessarily yourselves. You question, and as you know, organizations managing that process, was it done by the company themselves, by competitors, by angst and so on. So particularly in our model, which we're very excited about, which I think is going to be game changing in how you buy used cars in the UK, is that member community that we have, where you've got TVR experts and even all the way through the range of brands. Their view, where you can see is a member of the public who's driven this thing to death, knows it inside out, and they've put their comments in. And when we've got, they've driven driving style and their mileage per gallon and what went wrong and this, that, and the other, what the replacement costs were, community generated. And also we've got data sources coming in. If you combine that up, and you might only have 4 or 5 of those, versus 30 vanilla one sentences, and I'm more than confident, I'll let you know in 16 weeks' time when it launches. Don't let the Auditor Trader guys here, so maybe not so 16 weeks, guys.
It's about 12.
Yeah. It's tomorrow. And, you know, that is what's going to really drive the conversion, because what we see on, if I look at a used car, it's like a product. You know, you're trying to manage the leakage of that page. So we convert that 2% FYI off a page to a lead. So I've got to make that 4%. So I don't want them going to a manufacturer site to get the detail, or another review site, or going to Auto Trader or Gumtree to see a similar vehicle. So if you can bring all the community content in, I'm very fortunate at Haymarket, we have Auto Car, What Car, Classic Car, Sports Car. I bring all that authoritative content in together, the blend of where we've got opinion and then where the members have got opinion combined. And we can build out a really beautiful experience, because no one knows, we're very passionate in our business, no one knows more about cars than us and our members. So if we can build that out and be really focused and driven on doing that, we hope that's the strategy that's going to see us through.
Where's that content sitting in terms of on site versus, is it separate, the content section, the forum section, or is it near the products you're selling?
Brilliant question. So right now, you're absolutely right. So it's all distributed. And so what we're working through now is integrating all that to become a beautiful, particularly mobile, it's all
so
mobile.
One full, really, really long page.
Really long page. In fact, actually, proudly, obviously we've got little navigation buttons. If I open up a page, it goes from the ceiling to the floor. That's the intensity. So it's like in property, you know, people have got the, and you know, there's still ways to go on that. People are looking at how they incorporate user membership and crime stats, all that type of thing. We're the same view about that product. But the members' comments are going to really drive that, because you know, it's all great when manufacturers say such and editorial people say such. But if you can get the whole rounded picture, and that's what your business is doing, cultivated, because they're quality individuals, you can see that, I'm pretty confident it's going to be something special. And then that's not costing us money, a bit of development money, but I've got all those assets sitting around. Yeah. So why would I go off and you know, something we'll talk about later, go market that when I can do that?
Do you find, or is there a risk that your guy in Bristol, for example, he's got his 400 cars every month or so, and the content that goes with that, is there a risk, and in fact, is it a risk if that ends up on Facebook, in a little group on Facebook that he started, rather than within the Pistonheads walled garden? Because that's what everybody's facing. Everybody's that audience. The content is being digested within a community or elsewhere,
absolute recognition,
in social rather than on your site.
Absolutely. So everyone talks about managing and running different platforms. So you know, within the Pistonheads community, that depth and context that we have, we're confident. You know, we've grown our audiences year on year. And interestingly, last year, where my biggest three competitors spent £30 million marketing their businesses, predominantly with wasteful TV advertising.
You've got it in there.
I'm really subtle.
Is it better, dear?
Yeah.
Oh, there you are. Hi. No wonder you're looking so like that.
That's why.
Yeah. I actually love
your guys are over there.
I know, I've already checked them out.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's hello, my name's... So, are you prepared to talk about any of the measurement techniques you use on your site? How are you actually working out that you've got really great engagement?
Yeah, so, kind of... All the obvious.
Hello, my name's Tom Bowman. I'm very late, but I've walked from Camden, so you can have something.
We're all
sitting
together. We're all from Waterloo. You're not one of us.
Yeah. So, great question, Tom. So, you got to all the obvious ones you'd normally do would be the engagement times and the fact that people are on the site for 7.5 minutes. How many comments are they making?
Okay, but I'm going to get really technical here, though. So, but what? Just working off Google Analytics, or have you got something professional?
So we use a number of products. So we've got the GA premium on steroids, but still Google solution. We use products like Chartbeat to identify the user base. We've got our own routines.
Bingo.
So that's the key, because what we've...
There's a reason why. I don't want to be geeky, but there's a reason why, is it? Because you say something really quite provocative, which was... All these people spent all this money doing TV advertising. I'm getting away with doing it virtually for nothing. But most marketers would need to know what sense of the universe they've got and whether they're actually reaching the universe or not. Because you can be doing very well in your own pond.
Correct. Yeah.
And the reason why I mentioned Google Analytics is not to have a go at Google, because I'm a great fan. I have to say that, don't I? But but because methodology is really important if you're using tools. Mm-hmm. And the Chartbeat tool uses big data. Every raw piece of data, you put it on your site, it will capture every single thing that happens. Many, many other tools, including one we might already have mentioned, are actually sampling. Yeah. And so unless people stay on the site long enough, you won't really know what on earth is going on. So I don't want to get too geeky, but that's why I asked the question.
To the point, they're also tracking engagement.
Yes. You
know, we put the metrics in there. So a lot of publishers over the last 2 years and probably retailers have chased the unique number. And there's sites out there that have got 40 million unique numbers in the UK. Oh, that's just absolutely magic. They don't do anything. Well, that's a waste of pointless exercise. And a huge amount's coming from social media. And say half the traffic's 1.5 pages per visit.
So how many Pistonheads are there in the UK then?
So 4.5 million uniques.
That's how many you
per
want.
Month. Yes. But in universal terms of the total, we think about 7 to 8. 7 to 8. Who are in that sort of sector of that car marketplace, which is significant. There's only 20 million cars on the road, it's quite a significant number, and that's one of the things we're doing.
So for the panel, because I can't, as much as we can spend the whole time talking there, it sort of comes to the how you build your audience question, isn't it? And obviously engagement's really massive with something like Pistonheads, but if you come across all the way across to something that we said in the preparation work, which is where, how much social, we're here talking about community and content and comments. You said something on the phone about, well, Instagram's a really good way of marketing.
Yeah. I think fashion, first of all, it's visual. I was thinking about the importance, somebody said about selfies. You know, what does that mean? And what's behind selfies? And in fact, I think it gives the power to the audience. And Instagram is immediacy. And I was just thinking about whenever Rihanna post something that she might have bought from Browns on her Instagram, well, we know not only does it work, but it produces results. And that's something that is very immediate and it's measurable. I think for fashion, the immediacy, the visual part, probably outweighs the content. I mean, I was just imagining how boring it must be, sorry, Lee, but to go and scroll down to find out all those different details about, you know, your car. But fashion, is like, I like it, I want it, I'm going to go and see it. And it's a pretty immediate...
Am I allowed to do what I think you were doing, Jamie? Which is, we're a small enough group, and just to see how people feel about that. So you've got the Pistonheads piece, and then you've got much more fashion oriented. Do either of those phrases chime with what you're doing yourselves at the moment? Anybody want to volunteer? If I got the list beforehand by arriving on time, I'd be able to go, right, let's ask. So I might just have to point at someone, or someone who's nodding in the front. I can see from here.
Cool. So the reason I was going to come to it was I did some work with a luxury fashion brand a number of years ago, and they were terrified of having somebody appear to speak on their behalf. So I was wondering particularly how Simon feels about having brand advocacy from people who are not experts in the brand, and people who may not personally represent all the brand's values that they'd like to have manifestly presented. So, because clearly you're seeing value from people taking selfies, sharing it, and putting it in the social space, and then contributing elements of that to the community, you're clearly seeing the benefit of that. Whereas people I've dealt with historically in the past, we're always scared of losing control.
Sure. So I mean, with the big brands, we have probably about 90% of our brands online, but there are one or two brands, Dior, for instance, or Celine. I don't know if any of you know. These are two French brands that belong to LVMH, and they absolutely hate web. They hate it, and it is about control.
They are French.
No. You've got to go back to the individuals, but it's the fear of losing control. And I think the whole idea, anyway, the whole internet, the whole idea behind it, it's open. And of course, you're going to get some people who will be posting something that won't particularly be correct or accurate. But, you know, on the whole, it's
sabotage is very low.
Yeah.
What about a solution to maybe you're doing this, but if you had the product item there that Rihanna had purchased in your shop process, but below that you had, right there and there on that, you're probably getting 1% conversion on that, you had the video of Rihanna or photos of Rihanna doing that and various other interesting people who bought that, would that not drive more conversion?
Well, I'll answer that very quickly. Again, we're talking about. You know, this is.
Tell him you got it right.
No, this is luxury fashion. The sell or the push is pretty subtle. They know it's kind of the unknown, and in fact, that's actually one of the tags that Farfetch. It's the sort of the people who do know, so you don't have to. There's no hard sell, not at our level.
And so you talk about a very loyal audience.
We have a loyal.
You've been doing it for 45 years.
Yeah,
as you guys
a lot. Yeah, but I think those, today we have about 500,000 people that visit our site every week. Wow. Of course, why are they visiting? I mean, the conversion is pretty low. But the content is very rich, and they come to us because they know they're going to find out who's the newest designer. So
some people don't like the web, particularly if maybe they're fashion brands from elsewhere. Yeah, there's not enough of us to vote. It's too personal to vote. But here's Troy sitting in the middle, who's built three digital businesses in a row, and now has one which is entirely about endorsement. You've probably told everybody already. So. You're sort of sitting in the middle in both ways, really.
Yeah.
Right, on this panel. Did you do that on purpose? And
because
either it's horses for courses, and you go different routes, or it's an and answer, or we actually really, or it's about demographics, or we really, really shouldn't be frightened, or something. So what's the answer, Tron?
So, well, It's a big question. I think.
Yeah, yeah.
So it. It's fundamentally exactly what we do. You know, trying to harness the value of advocacy. Ultimately, that's what we're doing. And so, right now, we're not actually chasing the celebrity endorsement, albeit we believe that there's probably a good market there for us in the future, because we are going after what we believe to be the more sophisticated shopper, probably the more Browns type customer. And not to compete with Browns, but also to drive traffic to Browns, because we're a publisher, we're not a retailer. Mm-hmm. So the fulfillment happens on the retailer site. So what we think is, you know, we're talking about expert endorsement and or community or UGC. Mm. It is a bit of both, but certainly when it comes to something like fashion, if you compare it to, we were talking about TripAdvisor before, you know, the idea that with fashion, everything that's written about is ultimately an endorsement. You don't open a fashion magazine and somebody says, "Don't buy this." Mm. Every fashion magazine says, "Buy this." So it's very easy. It's very good, and so those opinions actually really matter.
But are you opening yourself up to the possibility of it didn't show up on time? It wasn't the size it said it was going to be. You know, it wasn't quite worth the money.
I'd like to think you know, customers are pretty sophisticated. You know, it's sort of if we're saying this is the stuff that you should buy. It's not our fault that it's sold out. You know, yeah. Almost actually, that's one of our sort of what we think is one of our USPs. Why people should join us is because the most sought after products do sell out, and so we show you what those are going to be before the masses know, and so you've got the best chance to buy them by, you know, becoming a member of Endorse. So,
and would that not defend Simon's prices?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think there's been a full revolution in terms of you know, the discount market, the flash sales for fashion, flash sales for, you know, lots of different sites. I think there's a time where, when it comes to, you know, certainly high-end fashion and fashionable things, people are quite happy to pay the full price because they want it. They want that thing. They, you know, generally when it's on sale, it's last season. So, you know, it's a different kind of shopper, I think. I mean, you probably know more about that than I do. But
well, I think something you said about secrets escapes. I mean, when somebody buys a Celine bag on sale, they're not going to go and tell their friend when they're sitting in the restaurant.
Yeah,
bag.
No, of course not.
It's got a sale mark on it. Not at all.
It's very different.
Quite the opposite.
Do you know what, though?
I don't know if they're smug, but they're happy because they bought something that they like.
There's a very big, you're exactly right. And the reason why flash sales actually do work exceptionally well for travel still, but maybe not so much for fashion, is because of exactly that. When you have a hotel room, in peaks and troughs of the economy and all the rest of it, the hotel room doesn't go anywhere. So what Secret Escapes does, you know, our kind of strap line is even the best hotels have empty rooms. So they don't come in and out of fashion. That's the key thing, is that, you know, if you do get a cheap price for a hotel, that's actually something to be quite proud of, because somebody else has paid more than you.
So we've got a different piece here, haven't we? We've got perishability as opposed to the possibility of end of line and getting it in some.
There's a massive bit. I mean, there's a massive business. There's a website in France called venteprivée.com, and Secret Sales have copied it. And Vente Privé is a billion euro business.
Yeah.
Immense. So people love to buy on sale. Why wouldn't they? If you can get a good bargain, why not?
Yeah. Do you ever trade with them?
No, we're not big enough. That's and we don't have enough we don't have enough volume, but they're appealing to, I mean, that's a community, and they're what they're doing, in fact, they answered a real need from a supply point of view. Mm. Suppliers didn't know how to clear goods, and they came along and they said, "Look, this is what we're going to do." And I remember I did do an operation with them in my other job in Paris, and I remember we had a licensee for bed linen. I mean, it's the most difficult kind of product to sell, bed linen. There's very little distribution, and this guy, beautiful bed linen, cleared everything in 48 hours. Mm. And he called me and I said, "I can't believe it." So there's an enormous appetite you know, discounted product. It's got to be good, because it was good. And in fact, what they do, they're very, very selective. Mm. And again, it comes back to the customer. The customer's savvy. Mm. So as long as it's good.
I think it leads on to the commerce thing and the community. All their retailing, you've just got to clearly understand who that member is. And, you know, I imagine most people are putting in data platforms at the moment. We have one. We've got about 1,000 bits of data for any motorist that visits our websites. So that personalization of that content and that offer has to be spot on. And in a community model, you've got to be really careful. You know, we don't bombard them daily, the flash model. Mm. It's every It works for you great. You know, that would, they would run a mile.
So is there a Bombarda daily in the room? Yes. Oh yes, there's one here, right here. But before I come back to you,
Sport Pursuit.
Oh yes.
So, flash sales. I like being Bombarda.
A daily Bombarda.
What company?
Sport Pursuit.
Yeah. And so the reason why you do that is brackets. It works.
It's news.
But apart from that,
it's news.
It's news. It's news stories. So we and people who sign up to the site sort of educated enough to know that they're going to get that. Right. So we've got a reason to contact them. Whereas Auto Trader, if you did that, then
with the Pistonhead community, So how often do you keep in touch with that audience
daily.
Of yours?
Daily
communicating. But how much of the time are you making it over? Are you having enough? Is this enough contact? Is this enough? You know,
asking them.
Yeah, asking for their continued permission, as it were, to be hitting them
so
on.
So we're sort of doing CRM analysis to figure that out.
So you're kind of doing it amongst yourself. I see. So you're.
Yeah. But do you personalise and segment it down?
Yeah.
So if you respond, you get hit more.
The nature
on
is that there is going to be a higher unsubscribe rate than if you emailed them monthly. But what revenue do you lose out on that based on that? So the unsubscribe rate is higher, but you're still getting people in the door.
It's about tolerance though, right? Like with a site like Sports Pursuit and with Secret Escapes, the sales last for 7 days. There's a new sale every day. If you don't buy it now, you miss out on it. And so customers are
so you
tolerant.
Sort of don't
to it.
Have to hit them too hard.
No, you do have to hit them.
You have to hit them.
You hit them daily, but the point is they're tolerant to it because actually, you know, who doesn't? Well, certainly when it comes to those sorts of sites, Sport Pursuit, Secret Escape, Secret Sales included, who doesn't want to kind of just speculate? Sorry, speculatively to have a little peek.
Yeah, but surely
Jamie's being forceful here. He's got
being forceful. So we should talk about the email thing because
we had
a conversation about email marketing prior to this, and I know you guys are the big users of what's next. Because you know, you're the only one that I don't delete every morning.
What are you?
I get 30 emails when I wake up.
So how much time do we have? Because I wanted to come back to the next bit.
Simon's got 4 minutes.
He's got 4 minutes. Okay, then that's all right. Because there's a thing we can talk about with the difference between expert content and non-expert content. But you sounds like you've mostly been there. And so the piece here is which comes out of the aggregation of expert opinions and new technologies and things of that order. So you talked about Instagram. And the wisdoms of crowds. I brought up when we were talking about on the phone, products like WhatsApp, which some people say into the full same bucket as Instagram. So, what are the limits of email? Where do we go? Where are people going with different ways of marketing now? Maybe the floor knows the answer to this. Anybody marketing on WeChat?
Yep, I was just going to tell you about WeChat because I don't know if everybody.
Excellent. Catch the last 4 minutes.
Yeah. Okay, so I was in. I went to China in September last year with a group of luxury brands, and we have a strong Chinese customer. Principally, they're students that in colleges here, and they're very wealthy, and they shop, in brands, and they shop every week. Anyway, so we have some Chinese salespeople, and I said to Wendy. Put me on WeChat. So anyway, I downloaded WeChat and off I went. And when I was in Shanghai, I was literally, every time I gave out a business card, I then took out my phone and I said, are you on WeChat? And they said, oh yeah, I'm on WeChat. I said, can we WeChat together? So we would scan.
They didn't talk like that.
But they didn't talk like that. So we scanned, you know, because you scan your mobile and and I think whilst I was there, I must have picked up about 300 people. Mm-hmm. And this community, because it is a community, is now linked to Brown's WeChat because we now post on WeChat every week. Mm. And again, it's not to sell, although they can buy through our website. But it's to again, it's to spread the word, and our approach was well, China is, you know, you weren't. I didn't see a China.
We do.
You do, because
it's, of course, it's a great market. But the question is, you know, you've got to know where you want to go and who you want to go with. And I felt that this was the way for brands, which is the network.
So how much do you know about the audience beyond the geography of the audience? Do you know anything about the demographics? Do you know anything very much about
them? Not yet. But we know that they're certainly interested in fashion. I mean, they came to meet me at this event. And, of course, the word spreads. And our goal was to make sure that Browns as a luxury emporium is known in China, or at least to a community that loves fashion, whether they can afford it or not, doesn't matter, but it's building the brand. So we see it very much as a PR tool that one day, when we have a fully fledged Mandarin website, will convert into sales.
Mm-hmm. So anybody else?
I'm upsetting now.
He's taking up.
Yeah. No. Unfortunately, I have to disappear. But I just wanted to share that with you guys because I think there's only 500 million people on WeChat.
So
it's clearly not going to catch on. So anybody else in doing any form of chat app marketing? There's one here. Hello. Can you for my benefit, sir? Oh, right, splendid.
Luxury mobile phones.
Doing something slightly better than Nokia. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yes. Sorry if you're a Nokia person.
We are actually ex-Nokia.
Yeah.
A little bit touching. We've actually explored WeChat and Weibo. And operate across both of them because the two platforms go hand in hand in each one. Weibo is more about broadcast corporate messaging and WeChat is more about engagement. I can't say that we're absolutely where we should be.
Any direct commerce, or is it mostly about awareness?
WeChat is very much directing to sales, mm-hmm. and it's engagement, and it's finding out how much is the price, and you know all the good stuff that we always get asked again and again and again. I would say the learnings that we've taken, that we're not there, not even close, is that you can't just say, particularly for Weibo and WeChat, we can't just say, okay, we're going to put the Western way of doing business and plop it into China, because it doesn't work. Mm. It doesn't work. They don't do emails. Their open rates are so low, it's hardly worth bothering about. It's WeChat, and it's about tapping into the local market and actually getting somebody on the ground to actually educate you, because you can't do it from you.
So my perception of the internet from is that in Western communities we've probably not seen as much diversity in the way it all works, and the idea of it being PC based and then a little bit and then make your website work on mobile. That's actually all a very web way of thinking. As Simon Lefty said, there are 500 million people on WeChat. There's a similar number on a service called Line, L-I-N-E, which is a Korean-Japanese service, which now has 20 million users in Spain. Spain has a population of 40 million. Yeah. And so within this year, half the Spanish or... And as it appears to be, that some of these services' ambition is to become... if you're old enough, like I am, to remember the early days of the internet, and AOL was a walled garden that you got on narrowband. Lee and I go back that far. Nobody else probably does. But there's an element to which some of these services are a little bit like a recreation of that world. On WeChat in China, you can not only book a China Eastern's airline ticket, you can also download the boarding pass all inside your chat app. Yeah, that sounds like a walled garden. And so if you're trying to communicate, and so these people may not necessarily go in the way of email. So that's why we're asking the question. And it's interesting that you're there. And I didn't see any other hands go up. I'm keen to let Paul back in, because you did have another question. Was it for Simon?
It was more broad, and I think actually probably more for Troy than anything else. And he's trying to understand this interplay between community content and discounting off price. So obviously, Troy having done secret escapes, and it's based on discounting and flash sales, but now doing endorse, it's almost the opposite model. Mm. It's because retailers don't really want to be doing discounting or off-price.
Yep.
Some people do off-price secretly as well.
Yep.
What kind of view do we have on that? Because, you know, I mean, it erodes margin, but converse point in question is, does that enable people to buy into a brand at a lower price point and then start to establish loyalty going up?
Yep.
So, and does community have an element of interplay with that?
So, it is a bit of a kind of delicate balance, if you like. So for a company, well, for the flash sales side, so Sports Pursuit, Secret Escape, Secret Sales, you know, these businesses are constantly trying to add value to their clients whilst at the same time promising them that they're never going to devalue their proposition. So for Secret Escape specifically, when we talk to hotels, we do actually say the words, you know, pretty much it's guaranteed that every single hotel, no matter how good you are, you're not going to be 100% occupied 100% of the time. And if you do the simple maths on that, if you've got a 100-room hotel at £300 a night, that's at 90%. You're talking about 30 grand's worth of rooms that haven't been
But are
sold.
You thinking about that point? Are you thinking about coming in low and then as people get used to this idea working up, you know, the classic innovator's dilemma concept of going in the bottom and then going up market after?
So the way we view it, or the way that we kind of pitch the proposition, is to say, look, you know, it's no good for a hotel to go and give a massive discount to the likes of Expedia or Booking.com because that's a publicly available service, and they will demand it. You know, they will literally, there will be people that have paid the £300 rack rate, and they'll turn up and then they'll see on Expedia, they go, well, hang on a minute, that was 100 quid.
And they end up saying at the desk, if
they're actually legally obliged.
Never knowingly undersold and all that.
Well, actually,
and also, yeah,
in a lot of countries, they're legally obliged to actually give them the discount back. So there's a big damage reputation there. So the thing with the flash sale sites is that they only last for 7 days. It's a private members club. So there's all these little bits that make it so that actually it's
paid private members club?
No, it's private. No, it's all
Why
free.
Not paid private members club?
Epic scale. You need to have scale.
Epic scale.
But then when it comes to, you know, I've come full circle, so I've had a lot of experience in that side of the business. And what got me interested in fashion was that, you know, I wasn't being disparaging about the flash sale models for fashion at all. I think, well, I'm actually an investor in Sports Pursuit, so that's fine.
So it's not going to be fisticuffs.
No, we love it. But I think that, you know, there's a different type of customer, and it's absolutely valid for somebody to want to capitalise on, you know, at end of season stock and that sort of thing. But there's also equally just as many, if not more, customers out there who are different customers who are quite happy to pay full price.
So Lee's nodding though, Jamie.
It's different mindsets, isn't it?
It's different mindsets.
Yeah. You know, it'll be a bit similar in correlating the model that we run.
Because you don't think about it as being bottom of the market or anything with Pistonheads.
Far from it. It's all premium, super, and it's an aspirational dream. And lots of charts that show that it's actually an investment rather than a depreciation model. And once the property market collapses, we'll be in a great place. But the model of that is, you know, in that competitive set, there's three or four decent players, and if you looked at the cookie numbers, you know, it would be 20 million cookies a month. Well, there's only 1 million, just under a million cars sold per month. Mm. So it's far too many. So everyone's coming at different positionings. And that's how you're going to get a cut through, which most brands do anyway. So you're positioning by an attitude, you're positioning by a purchasing process. So if you just segment things down rather than trying to do the whole classic I own everything process, then you'll get an angle, you'll get a win, you'll get a conversion funnel, and you'll get a loyalty process and a glue that hooks everyone to that particular brand.
I think I was just quickly going to mention, I have no content here, apart from that I'm going to steal some content from an event we ran last week. We ran a multi-channel event last week, and we had a group of panellists from Snow and Rock, Blue Ink, and Heels. And they were very clear in that all of them agreed that store customers pay 10% more than online customers, full stop. And they all had exactly that same margin differential. They all were of the view.
Does that ring true? Is anybody here who's there's a shake of the head?
No, we're our products.
And you're sorry, sir.
I'm Mike Shelton from Haynes Publishing.
All right.
So with our products, people spend a lot less online.
The differential's a lot bigger.
It's a 40% less.
Right. So we were having the debate was then. I'll be very quick. The debate was then, is that the same customer expecting different price points, just playing the store versus the web, or are they actually different customers who are behaving differently? And then follow on, has the retailer then trained us? Have we trained consumers to to expect a lower price online.
And did they?
Sorry,
this is. Yeah, we're talking about that. Did they? Sorry.
I work in Manjuri, and we see the opposite. Our average transaction value is higher online than it is in
And margin online is higher or spend?
Yeah. Transactions and margin. Yeah.
And do you see different demographics? Are they different audiences?
Oh well, it's much more because of the rarity of our product, so we're not sort of available.
So scarcity works.
So you know, obviously our demographic is different because we have a lot more international customers coming into the website. But you know, beyond that, it's pretty slim demographic.
And what about the debate last week? Did they identify the answer?
I think
that retail customers pay more.
They're starting to think that they've trained customers to expect a discount online.
Right.
Really, because it's the lever that retailers can pull. You know, last week of the month, you can't do much about the stores, but you can discount the crap out of online. And so we now, as customers, consumers, we...
You have to wonder whether there are very many people left that are still uncomfortable with the idea of buying online. I'm sure there must be some, but... that would be it.
Not an option.
So we only have 4 or 5 minutes left, so I've got more questions here, but I'm interested to know whether the conversation so far has provoked any other thoughts, any things that people really wanted to find out this morning and haven't so far, any things we should have said. I only know some of the things that they might, you know, the second half of what you might have said.
I'll ask a question. Dominating, sorry.
That's it.
Go for it. I was just wondering, especially with Endorse, where you're starting from a content point and you're trying to get them to the end user, mm-hmm. it's easy when you've got an audience and you, with Auto Trader, like you're in that environment, you're already just enhancing their purchasing experience. When you're so far away from the purchasing side of things, what type of content do you think converts people to sale?
So that's kind of
great question.
Fundamentally,
I had it written down here.
But it's from us. How far away do you go to the interest-led stuff or the really sort of?
Well, that's kind of the crux of the site is all about is actually, you know, by virtue of the fact that it's been featured in a magazine, you know, that in our mind is the context that's saying there's been a tick or a seal of approval from Vogue or Grazia or Cosmo or whoever, and just by virtue of the fact that they've written about it editorially, not in the advertising, but editorially they've said you should wear this. We don't quite know whether or not it's that drives purchase behaviour or whether or not it's the magazines who are detecting what future purchase behaviour will bring, but the fact of the matter is the stuff that goes in the magazines is generally what kind of gets bought, so it doesn't really matter which way it is. So that's you know, so we go right back to the I guess you'd call the intent generators, who are the publishers, the bloggers, the stylists, the editors, tell you what to buy and what to wear, and then you know what we're trying to do is help to harness that intent by having a much smoother transition for the consumer from that content straight through to the retailer such that they can buy it more efficiently.
I think it's about the psychology again of what you individuals really relate to. So if magazine content, and certainly in the UK I think we're very fortunate, I think all the vertical magazines in particular, the fashion ones you mentioned in What Car Order Car, actually if we don't like something, we say so. And that means we lose advertising quids, and I know that because I get those calls and deal with it. So you know, people trust those brands, and that's why they still sell huge numbers, even in the good old print world, with huge cover prices. So you've got that mentality, I really buy into what they're saying, and the quality and the brilliant people we have doing that, they're amazing people. And then you bring this community model in again, and you as an individual go, well, actually, yeah, I kind of get that magazine thing, but I want to see what these people think. Bring it in. If you're a data geek like me, and you want to know the specs of this and this, and where it was made, and where it was sourced, then have that as well. And then over time, you'll start seeing via the appropriate analytic tools you're doing which ones work for which people who come in. Mm-hmm. And I'd argue just go for everything you can to enrich the story of that product and all the great things you can tell about it, and over time work out what per person turn them on.
And there's one other criteria there, which is what mode they're in at the time. Are they in discovery mode? Are they in selection mode? And so we're starting to hear, just because we know all the hybrid vendors and all these guys, we're starting to hear about technologies that can personalize content in session based on the mode that the browser is in. which feels like a very sensible thing to go and do, because obviously everybody's now building huge amounts of content, not always absolutely sure why, and it's not always connected to the web page that you're looking at the time. So there are some interesting, I can talk about after, there's a couple of things that we're aware of that are people that are
just
doing
quickly to grab one more before we get scolded.
Just following on from that question, question for Troy, how do you, as a platform that aggregates all these endorsements, how do you establish your own tone and your own voice as a brand and not differentiate yourself from Hot Sugar and things like that? Is that important to you?
Yeah, it's really important. I mean, we're constantly having conversations about that. So we have an editorial team who, we write emails, we write blog posts and all the rest of it, and it's very important for us to not have the opinion. So we're trying to help disseminate what the opinion is, but we don't want to be competing with Vogue for their style advice. We don't want to say, well, we don't agree with you. What we're saying is, here's the information. And so where it becomes interesting is where you've got products that have got multiple endorsements from multiple different titles, bloggers and magazines alike. What's becoming actually even more interesting is we can see which publications are being influenced by who, because we track and timestamp when we see a product endorsed in a blog, for example, and you can start to see patterns of certain publications who are quite clearly stealing the content from lesser known blogs.
It's a familiar business model.
The modern equivalent of rewriting your press release.
Made famous by some Greek entrepreneurs and things like that.
Addition to that is on the Pistonheads brand, our editors write very detailed information. And they are amazing, almost motoring geeks, and a beautiful word. But they know, and they're very aware, that inside that community, there's someone who knows more than they do.
Yeah, guarantee.
Very aware, not threatened by it, conscious and aware. Yeah. And so if you can harness that and bring it in, so when you write something, expect them to come in to add value or disagree. And that's a really interesting mental state for content creation.
So I don't know if that totally answered the question, but there's a really good point about tone there. And any more for any more? I think we might be... I think you might have had the last word.
Yeah.
Oh, there is? No, you haven't.
I was just going to ask, what's your opinion about integrating content throughout commercial pages, so you put listing pages and product pages? Because we're on kind of a journey of creating more content to bring people to the site through SEO and get them to engage. But are you ex-designers are of the opinion of you've got someone to a product listing page, you've got someone to a product page, why would you want to take them away to then read about it and you're kind of distracting them from the conversion funnel?
I've got a good answer for that. So what's your conversion rate on those pages? But I'm assuming it's what, single digit percentage or less, or a percentage of a percentage, like 1 or 2%?
Yeah, every single digit, yeah.
So the question is, even if it's 2%, which would probably you'd be quite happy with, that means that out of 100 people that visit that page, 98 are going to go somewhere else anyway.
Yeah.
And where are they going? Are they going to find more information about that product because you've not given it to them? You know, if you can contain it there, but you know, you've got to test these sorts of things, and there is an argument they could be distracted, but there's an equal argument that 98 people out of 100 haven't got what they've found when they're looking at that page.
We have a little tool which allows us to A/B, and actually not A/B, but actually A/B/C/D/E
multivariate testing.
And I think it's interesting. I worked with Lonely Planet for quite a long time, and they spent ages not having the advertising on the e-commerce pages. And then they put the advertising on the e-commerce pages and it didn't make any difference at all to their conversion rate.
But then they made a load of advertising over there.
Yeah. But the guys at Snow Rock, for example, David Conn last week was talking about the fact that what he's desperate to do is on the bike page, the product page, that he's desperate to put the blog article, how to choose your new bike, next to it, which is relevant, will help, gives you a little bit of the advice that you would get in the store, and actually probably drives conversion. But at the moment, that content's in a blog.
And I think that's because human beings don't necessarily do go down the funnel. They actually go round and round and round. When you watch footfall round stores and things, that idea that it's always some sort, it can be controlled, I think is actually one of the things, but testing's the only way. But we are apparently really having to wrap up now. And so thank you very much for beating the traffic somewhat better than I did, and for coming along, and it's 20 past 10, somewhere after 20 past 10. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.